One time I bought a drone, and the story behind that is that one time in my, and I was in my bedroom, a drone flew up to my window, just sort of like lazily came in through the window, and then just sort of flew off. I'm like, well, that was weird. Coincidentally, I went to a hobby shop, and while I was there, I was looking at stuff, and then this strange thing happened. Right in one of the aisles was this thing, which is this one right here, and so I bought it. And this talk today is actually going to be more of live hacking this thing. We're going to run through like four nights of work in 30 minutes. So this is the drone, and it's a pretty simple quarter meter frame. You can get it on Amazon. They cut the price after Christmas. It's cheap now. I figure one of my neighborhood kids just got it as a Christmas present. And interestingly, there's this little guy. This is what we're going to be focusing on. It's this, I know you can't see it, but it's this tiny little module that's hanging off the bottom. You'll actually find this module on a bunch of other drones, interestingly enough, with different everything else's. And that's a close-up. It's got a little camera and a flex PCB. This is a 4-pin connector, and we'll get into that later. This is a battery option that mine doesn't have, so it gets power over the 4-pin connector direct from the drone. But you can get this for like an RC car or any other thing that you want to add a Wi-Fi enabled camera to. It's pretty neat. All right, so yeah, the module itself is $50, which is funny because you can get the camera, the drone for $65, and that's it. So I will ask that you guys do not actually hack this thing while I'm using it, just because I will totally teach you how to destroy these things, and that'll go real poorly if you do that while I'm up here. So first things first, you gotta just power this thing on. It takes a little bit to start up. And what happened to me was pretty odd. I couldn't connect to this with my phone. I could connect to it over Wi-Fi, but their app didn't work. And it turns out one of my friends, Jen Pfault, helped me figure out that older versions of Android, the app works fine, and on Android 7 or higher, they don't have their permissions set up right, so they like do DNS requests, MDNS stuff, and it just doesn't work. So the drone is starting up, and it's going to take me a little bit to connect to it over Wi-Fi. And oh, I also want to give a shout out to Randy Childers, who, if you look at this drone while it's tilted, it flashes at you to tell you not to take off. And that it really wants to be level to take off, sort of like that. Funny story, last month at SETKC, Randy pointed out that if you hold it perfectly level upside down, it'll actually stop blinking. And in fact, this is a valid launch configuration. If you do this with your hand on the other side, it will launch straight into your hand. The vector needs to be lined up, but up and negative up are just as good. Alright, so we got an access point. You can't really see what's going on while I connect. And still connecting. Ah, boy, that's terrible. Still connecting. Oh man, this may all not work at all. There we go. There we go. Default route 192.168.234.1. Let's just use Nmap real quick and see what's going on. In parallel, let's go ahead and start up a web browser. And we're just going to go over to here. And that's kind of neat. We have this, the phone app will never take you here. But if you look at this, it looks an awful lot like an IP camera. That's because it is. Who wants to guess the password for this web API?
Password!
It's admin. I also tried password and like one or two other things. Oh yeah, it wants to install a DirectX plugin, I think, and that doesn't work on Linux. So this is kind of neat. Basically, when I got this, the first thing I wanted to do was check out the video on the camera and like get that working. But since I didn't have the phone app, if you have the phone app, you know, tracing an RTSP stream is really easy. You just run TCP dump and you'll see the RTSP URL. You'll usually either see the mobile app saying, hey drone, where's your RTSP URL? And then it gets one, or else it's hard coded in the app. So I actually pulled down the plugin and the app and the iOS app and couldn't find the URL in any of them, so I was guessing it was like came off the thing.
What's RTSP?
RTSP is a protocol for streaming video, usually over UDP, and it's very common for just live streaming video, and it's supported by VLC and mPlayer. This is one of those cases where you should use mPlayer, and we will, because mPlayer supports not doing buffering, and VLC has never done that right. So we got a little thing. You can ask questions out loud. Definitely do that. Yeah, it turns out if you just start looking at the source code, you're going to find there's a bunch of Chinese. It turns out you'll also find that this is shared with a whole bunch of other security cameras and other things that have IP cameras on them. And then eventually, if you find player.js, you'll find RTSP :// This is the start of an RTSP URL. Hooray! document.location.host, I think that's this, and /playchan, which is either 11 or 12. Neato. So, can I get an assistant? Joel, come here. Hold this thing pointed at these people. You don't worry about the wires, I'm not going to turn it on. The remote is off. Yeah, that's good. Just like that. Hey, there's the video stream. This is the same stream that you would get on your phone. It's a little bit laggy because there's a bunch of you probably with Wi-Fi on your phones right now or your laptops. That's all right. It's not a whole lot better if you fix that. RTSP can be done well. It's not great here. I wouldn't recommend flying this drone live. Off of RTSP, or off the video stream. It's kind of neat, the controller actually has a little handle where you can stick your phone in and it's like stretchy and it holds it for you. But still, it doesn't work with my phone and that's super annoying. So, but by this point I can fly it with my laptop and that's good enough. So, what else? There's other stuff you can do in here. Like, system, you'll find somewhere in here, device info maybe? You'll find that this basically tells you the image processor that's used and the image sensor. These are the two main components of a IP camera. Image processor usually has either Wi-Fi or a way to talk to Wi-Fi or an Ethernet card built in. This is the software version which confirms that this firmware is different from all the other IP cameras, which is kind of neat. Someone put in a tiny amount of effort here. They didn't just rip it off somebody else's camera, which you can totally do. So that's basically all we're going to be doing in this UI. You can actually do things like set up Wi-Fi correctly with passwords in here. You'll note that, well, I guess you couldn't see me connecting because I didn't set up the projector right. But these all come with an open access point, which we will totally take advantage of later. All right, thanks, mPlayer. Hey, nmap worked. There we go. Yeah. So, what do you do with Telnet? This is going to get kind of interesting. So what do you guys want to guess the username is? Whoa, what just happened? Get PWNAM return null. If you don't know what get PWNAM is, this is a function in your system's C library, like on Linux, which will go and find a record in etc password, and it will return null if that person isn't in there, which is weird. It turns out that, so basically, whatever you type for password does not matter here. The only one that it does not barf on, like, here's me. Oh, isn't that interesting? Right, I backdoored my camera. Root is the other one. So what we're going after here is the root password. Okay, so it turns out that the easiest way to do this is just to take it apart. So I will show you a photo of what that looks like. is... This is a USB serial adapter. These are three lines. Take note of that. Do not hook up, you need to power, sorry, do not hook up power. Don't hook up power. The thing will freak out real crazy because you'll only give it 3.3 volts and it needs 3.7 right off the battery. Hook up RX and TX. I can show you where those go on here. If you open this guy up, and I wish I had a picture of it cut open, there are four solder pads on the board, and they're definitely just a UART, like you find on most embedded products. And it's totally a UART. You can talk to it. The baud rate's 1150-200, which is the default for all cameras made on this chipset. And now we can talk to it. For convenience sake, I have included with my drone a USB cable. In other news, if you aren't running Debian testing, DMessage isn't going to work by itself. So you have to use sudo, and then we find this is a USB board. Hey, that's neat. Same thing. This is basically our telnet server again, except it's really listening on a local serial console. That's pretty cool. But what happens when we reboot this drone? Press the any key. Whoa. Hey, Joel, do you want to come back here and help me with something? I'm really sorry, Joel. Can you hold the space bar while I plug this wire in? Hey, oh, here you go. All done. All right. So this is the bootloader. And if you guys haven't ever used U-boot before, this is U-boot. And basically, with U-boot, this is a lot like Grub or Lilo in the early days when you forgot your root password and then you say, hey, why don't you just drop me into a root shell? So we'll just do that. And so we're basically gonna go set env. We look here, we have, oops. All the environment variables for the system. And here's some boot args. These are the ones that go to the kernel. That's pretty cool. And again, I have to fiddle with this thing to make it go. It also does not take well to changing your console size. It does not like that. So now we just enter in a new thing where we set env. Boot args. And then we set some boot args. Always bring a real mouse when you're presenting live. Well, that totally worked even though I didn't want it to. Boot args, tick, paste. Come on.
Extra CRL in there.
Yeah, I think I have something messed up in my terminal. But we're gonna get this right one at a time. Setenv, boot args, tick, mem equals 42 mem, stuff, init equals bin sh. And then normally it'll run this command for you on startup, upgrade, and then a bunch of other stuff. I don't know what upgrade does, so we're not gonna do it. But we just do this. Copy and paste. And now it's all loading up Linux and doing its stuff. And eventually what should happen is it should just, oh look, now we're root. So that's pretty neat. I wonder what they used to encrypt their passwords. I'm only gonna show you the first line because my backdoor is still in here. And so basically at this point I said, neato, I'm gonna add my own. And you can, there's no text editor, so you can totally just copy this over to /temp/password, use file pipes to append a new line. If you want to do this, you want to make a new one with a new username, But you want to set the user IDs to be zero, so that way you can log in with your own username and password, and it will just dump you out in a root shell whenever you, you know, as root immediately, which is really handy. Cracking this password will take you a total of about 20 minutes on a real computer, which is, you know, computer, fast computer from 5 years ago. We'll just use John the Ripper right on that file that we copy off the file system. And, EV1324. So, I should have mentioned, this talk will not be highly technical. We have done all of the fun stuff already. It goes downhill from here. So, now we have the root password for the system. That's kind of neat. And right around this time, some guy named Alex from the internet emailed me when I posted this on my blog, and he's like, how did you crack that? And I explained how to use John the Ripper. He had done all of the hard work the hard way. So what he did was actually tap the flash between the CPU and its storage that it boots off of, and ripped all of it, and then took it apart until he found the etc password file and like got stuff there. So kudos to Alex from the internet for going the hard way. But my drone totally has a backdoor on it, which is super neat. So if we go ahead and reboot this guy, it will come up, and we can totally just log in and start using it. And this will take a little bit. During that time, I think it's a good time to move into the next thing that we made, which is... Oh, I guess we should just do a quick overview of drone security. Like, what did they do wrong? They used open Wi-Fi authentication. It turns out if you just print the password to your drone, on the sticker, you can do a much better job of preventing people from getting access to other people's drones. But they didn't do that. And then they shared the same root password everywhere. It was also stored in etc password, which doesn't seem like a huge problem because there's only one user that's root on the system. So the web server, if you ever got the web server traversal that's to work, that's in the ancient 2003 version of the web server, you would totally be able to read etc password and then crack the password and get in that way too. What did they do right though? Funny story, that picture, if you look really closely, they saved some money here. They didn't do this for you. They did this because to save money, this is the drone view module that we're working on, and this is the drone itself. The drone itself receives radio commands from the transmitter, and then when you click the like picture or video button, it'll send those commands over a UART, which is those three lines, to the drone view. If you look really closely, there's only three lines, and since the drone powers the drone view, two of them are power and ground. The other one is a UART, but it's only half a UART. There's no way for the drone view to actually send data to the drone, which means that accidentally, by saving, you know, a fraction of a cent worth of cost, they've built a data diode, which is like something that you use for storing logs to make sure that your logs end up on the log server and not some hacker that's gonna delete all your logs. So this is actually a really awesome security feature purely by accident. This means that we cannot crash other people's drones physically, but we can totally do other things about this. So basically, we can automatically identify and log into these drones whenever we see them. And since the Wi-Fi starts up automatically, unless they've gone on the web UI and fixed that or added a password, it'll totally work. And the answer for how we want to weaponize that is this little microcontroller. This is an ESP8266. I wish I had a picture of it. They're usually $3 unless you get the Arduino compatible one, which is like $7. And it's a 32-bit microcontroller, like 64 megahertz, 48 megahertz or something. It's, I don't know, totally reasonable amount of horsepower. It comes with Wi-Fi built in. So if you get the little one, you can take a 7805 voltage regulator, a 9-volt battery, and the little microcontroller and tape it all together and have something that will automatically hunt down and remote wipe these drones. You could also brick them if you were a total jerk, which is, I'll show you how to do that, and I want you guys to not do that to my drone. And, I mean, like, you can totally put in a new init script that automatically deletes the SD card, or deformats it, or do whatever else you want. You could also upgrade it remotely and patch it, if you were so inclined, and we'll show you how to do that. So, just to prove that the thing works, try to connect to my, I don't need that. And then we're gonna have to switch laptops also, which is totally a thing. Hey Joel, I'm gonna need that port that you picked up plugged into this other laptop. Sadly, it takes a while to connect, which is kind of annoying, especially when you're giving a demo. I don't know. You guys probably can just trust that we have the root password and you can tell that into it, right? Other computer time. ESP8266 time. Okay, so this is the Arduino interface for ESP8266. And it turns out you can totally just build a little Arduino script widget thing. And this is one that I made. I actually made this to be the initial genesis of this program was a script that would run on the coffee machine at work, so that whenever we made new coffee, it would find an open access point, run NTP, and then draw the screen and say the coffee was made at this date and time. But instead, we're gonna do a couple of other things with it. Like, this one's, instead of running NTP, runs Telnet. And for now, we're just gonna run uname, because we're nice people, and if you were to do the other things to other people's drones, that would make you a bad person, and so you're not gonna do that. But yeah, so you could totally list all the video files that they store on their camera, or delete them. Or you could remove the bootloader so that the next time this drone lands, it doesn't start up again. Basically, you just do a little simple setup stuff for Arduino. And the key things here is that we're gonna go do a Wi-Fi scan. Man, you can't really see this. I'll just tell you what it does. It does a Wi-Fi scan, and then it works through the list and just says, is this a SSID that I know? Does it start with DroneView? If so, that's cool. Does it have encryption? No, delicious. And then we just connect to it. And over Telnet, we're just literally, this is the dumb Telnet client I wrote. It's basically TCP, so it barfs a bunch of binary data out in the console, but it just types the username, waits a little bit, types the password, waits a little bit, runs a thing. If you wanted to extend this, you could run more than one thing, but it turns out you can usually fit everything you need in one line of shell script. So that's all we do. And here it is, running. Some choice ones that I've seen. DNC was an inside job, very funny. Tell my Wi-Fi I love her. And let's see. Oh man, is the drone still running? It is still running. Let's see if we can just reboot this guy. Because what this should do is find the drone real quick, log in and run uname for us. I'm gonna go ahead and just restart up the Arduino stuff. I don't know how well Arduino deals with suspend resume. Oh, my COM port is not the same. Come on. Man, this is just a video of Richard not knowing how to use a computer. Sorry about that. Yeah, ports. That's where we want to go. It is comp. No, I shouldn't need that. Nah, that's cool. Hey, connecting to drone view, that's me. Tell me this is a binary junk I said was bad. Welcome to High Linux. That's the High Silicon people that made the chip. And there we go, it just ran uname, which on Linux just tells you what operating system it's on. Since we did not shut down the drone nor erase the bootloader, it will arbitrarily increase the kill count and print that out. It's now 2, and it'll be 3 because we didn't actually shut the thing down. Normally it would just wipe the device and then, you know, tell you how many things it had done that to. Bill, is that a single?
We have a tradition here.
We do, but this is my second time speaking. Why is there only one? I spoke when RSAXVC was zero or maybe negative 1 years old. That was delicious, by the way.
That was from the bartender.
Thank you.
B-size doesn't count. Yeah.
And so that's really all that I've got. I think we're right on half an hour. Do you guys have like any questions? I forgot to say to send them over Slack, which is cool because I didn't look at Slack while this was going on. What's up?
Is this attacking the drone or the camera?
This is attacking the camera on the drone, which attacks a bunch of different toy drones.
What's the best way to analyze a UAV?
What's your neighbor thing?
I am not 100% sure which one it is, and I'm not sure that they've flown up to my house since then. I mean, I would have to plug in a cable to do that, and I'm lazy.
Do you have any recommendations for attacking UART? Like, if you just see something?
Oh, yeah. So if you want to attack a UART just like I did, the only thing that you need to, the first thing to do is figure out the baud rate. If you have an oscilloscope, measure the length of the smallest bit, and basically one over that, and that's your baud rate, and set your serial port to do that. It may be binary, which is marginally annoying. If you have a USB serial adapter that will tell you about things like framing errors, you can actually tell a difference between a framing error and just garbage looking stuff is that your UART will receive that correctly. If you get a lot of framing errors, you probably just have the wrong baud rate. Once you get a baud rate, serial comp terminal though, it could be anything. You might be talking to like a GPS, you might be talking, if we had plugged into a different UART on the board, if I had soldered onto the other test points, the only thing we would have seen is a little tiny packet that goes from the drone's autopilot, well not even autopilot, flight controller, to say, hey, take a picture, and start the camera, stop the camera. That's the only thing available on that UART. On this one, it was really convenient that they just left the bootloader unlocked. And you'll see that a ton on embedded devices. It's just assumed that, I guess if you have physical security, there's no reason to even try. Which is sad whenever that works on other people's drones. Because all of, EV, I think 1324 is the password, is the root password for all drone view cameras that we've been able to find. I also mentioned earlier that this just barely dodged being part of Mirai. It turns out, so the Mirai botnet just had a big list of default usernames and passwords to go in over Telnet and then would basically use Netcat or curl or some other way to pull in a new binary and run it. And this username and password was not in the Mirai botnet. I know that, I wasn't going to waste your time with like me running through 30 usernames and passwords, but it's not in there. And it also, generally, these aren't internet connected, so you're usually pretty safe. I mean, that's fine, right? But no, they shouldn't have used the same password for all of them. They certainly shouldn't have hashed it with MD5. If you look up, that's what the password authentication type was in that Etsy password file that we looked at. Hey, Charles.
Which
web server software? Oh, web server software. It is running THTTPD, which is tiny HTTPD, from 2003. And there are several vulnerabilities for that, and it turns out it was just easier to solder some pins into the UART and hack the bootloader than do anything else with that. But theoretically, you should be able to escape the web server, like, chroot-ish area and read the Etsy password file that way. There's probably a bunch of stuff wrong in the Perl CGI bins also, because there's just a bunch of glue and strings together that looks kind of bad. But, I don't know, I had a soldering iron, and when you have a soldering iron, everything looks solderable. I don't know. You guys got anything else?
Does it have any other sensors?
Any other sensors? It has a camera you can shoot pictures and video, but and a microphone also. So you can also record audio. Basically, if you do this while it's flying, it just sounds like, and sometimes the noise changes pitch because there are just four giant motors right next to the mic, so that sounds really terrible. Can you transmit your own audio track to their recording? Yes. You can, you could basically just override, you just need to send the UDP packets in the RTSV stream and you need to increment the counter a little bit faster than the one by default does. And that would cause the audio to show up at their phone on time. Updating the audio on its way to the file is probably gonna be a little bit harder. I mean, you're Roots, you can do whatever you want, but it's gonna involve some like actual engineering to make that happen. Or you could do something silly that's just like a program that reads the MP4 file and removes the AAC track and puts a different one in whenever the file closes. That would be pretty funny and pretty easy to do. Tools like FFmpeg will actually do that for you, so all you would need is a copy of FFmpeg on ARM9, which is the CPU platform this uses, and that should totally work. That's a cool idea. I mean, yeah, you can totally just like rip the video off. And actually, I think that's a function of the web stuff of the website, is that you can get the videos over the web server somehow. I haven't figured out how to do that yet. It's mostly that I'm lazy and don't like to read manuals in Chinese. But yeah, as soon as the battery runs out, which is a real concern while giving a talk, the drone just dies and then your web server goes away.
Any funny Chinese comments in there?
I don't read Chinese. I do have a directory of funny comments found in other people's programs, but I'm sure there are some hilarious ones like, we'll deal with this later. We should probably verify that the bootloader is intact. That was a great one in a different product. That was in a Cisco piece of hardware. Well, yeah, so the thing looks pretty reliable. Yeah, totally works. I guess I'm going to turn it over to Juris to end the meeting.